Okay, reading number five for Philosophy 101, Henry Thomas Buckle's The Regularity of the Moral World. The believer in the possibility of a science of history is not called upon to hold either the doctrine of predestined events or that of freedom of the will. The only positions which, in this stage of inquiry, I shall expect him to concede are the following: that when we perform an action, we perform it in consequence of some motive or motives, that those motives are the result of some antecedents, and that therefore, if we were acquainted with the whole of the antecedents and with all of the laws of their movements, we could with unerring certainty predict the whole of their immediate results. This, unless I am greatly mistaken, is the view which must be held by every man whose mind is unbiased by system and who forms his opinions according to the evidence actually before him. If, for example, I am intimately acquainted with the character of any person, I can frequently tell how he will act under some given circumstances. Should I fail in this prediction, I must ascribe my error not to the arbitrary and capricious freedom of his will, nor to any supernatural prearrangement, for of neither of these things have we the slightest proof. But I must be content to suppose either that I had been misinformed as to some of the circumstances in which he was placed, or else that I had not sufficiently studied the ordinary operations of his mind. If, however, I were capable of correct reasoning, and if, at the same time, I had a complete knowledge both of his disposition and of all the events by which he was surrounded, I should be able to foresee the line of conduct which, in consequence of those events, he would adopt. Rejecting, then, the metaphysical dogma of free will and the theological dogma of predestined events, we are driven to the conclusion that the actions of men being determined solely by their antecedents must have a character of uniformity. That is to say, must, under precisely the same circumstances, always issue in precisely the same results. And as all antecedents are either in the mind or out of it, we clearly see that all the variations in the results, in other words, all the changes of which history is full, all the vicissitudes of the human race, their progress or their decay, their happiness or their misery, must be the fruit of a double action, an action of external phenomena upon the mind and another action of the mind upon the phenomena. The most comprehensive inferences respecting the actions of men, which are admitted by all parties in as incontestable truths, are derived from this or from analogous sources. They rest on statistical evidence and are expressed in mathematical language. And whoever is aware of how much has been discovered by this single method must not only recognize the uniformity with which mental phenomena succeed each other, but must, I think, feel sanguine that still more important discoveries will be made. So soon as there are brought into play those other powerful resources which even the present state of knowledge will abundantly supply. Without, however, anticipating future inquiries, we are, for the moment, only concerned with those proofs of the existence of a uniformity in human affairs which statisticians have been the first to bring forward. Of all offenses, it might be supposed that the crime of murder is one of the most arbitrary and irregular. For when we consider that this, though generally the crowning act of a long career of vice, is often the immediate result of what seems a sudden impulse, that when premeditated, its committal, even with the least chance of impunity, requires a rare combination of favorable circumstances for which the criminal will frequently wait, that he has thus to bide his time and look for opportunities he cannot control, that when the time has come, his heart may fail him, that the question whether or not he shall commit the crime may depend on a balance of conflicting motives, such as fear of the law, a dread of the penalties held out by religion, the prickings of his own conscience, the apprehension of future remorse, the love of gain, jealousy, revenge, desperation. When we put all of these things together, there arises such a complication of causes that we might reasonably despair of detecting any order or method in the result of those subtle and shifting agencies by which murder is either caused or prevented. But now, how stands the fact? The fact is that murder is committed with as much regularity and bears as uniform a relation to certain known circumstances as do the movements of the tides and the rotations of the seasons. M. Quetelet, who has spent his life collecting and methodizing the statistics of different countries, states, as the result of his laborious researches, that, quote, in everything which concerns crime, the same numbers reoccur with a consistency which cannot be mistaken, and that this is the case even with those crimes which seem quite independent of human foresight, such, for instance, as murder, which are generally committed after quarrels arising from circumstances apparently casual. Nevertheless, we know from experience that every year there not only take place nearly the same number of murders, but that even the instruments by which they are committed are employed in the same proportion, unquote. This was the language used in 1835 by confessedly the first statistician in Europe. And every subsequent investigation has confirmed his accuracy, for later inquiries have ascertained the extraordinary fact that the uniform reproduction of crime is more clearly marked and more capable of being predicted than are the physical laws connected with the disease and destruction of our bodies. Thus, for instance, the number of persons accused of crime in France between 1826 and 1844 was, by a singular coincidence, about equal to the male deaths which took place in Paris during the same period, the difference being that the fluctuations in the amount of crime were actually smaller than the fluctuations in the mortality. While a similar regularity was observed in each separate offense, all of which obeyed the same law of uniform and periodical repetition. This indeed will appear strange to those who believe that human actions depend more on the peculiarities of each individual than on the general state of society. But another circumstance remains behind, still more striking. Among public and registered crimes, there is none which seems so completely dependent on the individual as suicide. Attempts to murder or rob may be, and consequently are, successfully resisted, baffled sometimes by the party attacked, sometimes by the officers of justice. But an attempt to commit suicide is much less liable to interruption. The man who is determined to kill himself is not prevented at the last moment by the struggles of an enemy. And as he can easily guard against the interference of the civil power, his act becomes, as it were, isolated. It is cut off from foreign disturbances and seems more clearly to be the product of his own volition than any other offense could possibly be. We may also add that, unlike crimes in general, it is rarely caused by the instigation of confederates, so that men, not being goaded into it by their companions, are uninfluenced by one great class of external associations, which might hamper what is termed the freedom of their will. It may, therefore, very naturally be thought impracticable to refer suicide to general principles, or to detect anything like regularity in an offense which is so eccentric, so solitary, so impossible to control by legislation, and which the most vigilant police can do nothing to diminish. There is also another obstacle that impedes our view. This is that even the best evidence respecting suicide must always be very imperfect. In cases of drowning, for example, deaths are liable to be returned as suicides, which are accidental, while on the other hand, some are called accidental, which are voluntary. Thus it is that self-murder seems to be not only capricious and uncontrollable, but also very obscure in regard to proof, so that on all these grounds, it might be reasonable to despair of ever tracing it to those general causes by which it is produced. This being the peculiarities of this singular crime, it is surely an astonishing fact that all the evidence we possess respecting it points to one great conclusion, and can leave no doubt on our minds that suicide is merely the product of the general condition of society, and that the individual felon only carries into effect what is a necessary consequence of preceding circumstances. In a given state of society, a certain number of persons will put an end to their own life. This is the general law, and the special question as to who shall commit the crime depends, of course, upon special laws, which, however, in their total action, must obey the large social law to which they are subordinate. And the power of the larger law is so irresistible that neither the love of life nor the fear of another world can avail anything towards even checking its operation. The causes of this remarkable regularity I shall hereafter examine. But the existence of the regularity is familiar to whoever is conversant with moral statistics. In the different countries for which we have crimes, we find year by year the same proportion of persons putting an end to their own existence, so that after making allowance for the impossibility of collecting complete evidence, we are able to predict within a very small limit of error the number of voluntary deaths for each ensuing period. Supposing, of course, that the social circumstances do not undergo any marked change. Even in London, notwithstanding the vicissitudes incidental to the largest and most luxurious capital in the world, we find a regularity greater than could be expected by the most sanguine believer in social laws, since political excitement, mercantile excitement, and the misery produced by the dearness of food are causes of suicide, and are all constantly varying. Nevertheless, in this vast metropolis, about 240 persons every year make away with themselves, the annual suicides oscillating from the pressure of temporary causes between 266, the highest, and 213, the lowest. In 1846, which was the great year of excitement caused by the railway panic, the suicides in London were 266. In 1847 began a slight improvement. They fell to 256 in 1848. They were 247. In 1848, they were 247. In 1849, they were 213. And in 1850, they were 229. Such is some, and only some, of the evidence we now possess respecting the regularity with which, in the same states of society, the same crimes are necessarily reproduced. To appreciate the full force of this evidence, we must remember that it is not an arbitrary selection of particular facts, but that it is generalized from an exhaustive statement of criminal statistics, consisting of many millions of observations extending over countries in different grades of civilization, with different laws, different opinions, different morals, different habits. If we add to this that these statistics have been collected by persons specially employed for that purpose, with every means of arriving at the truth and with no interest to deceive, it surely must be admitted that the existence of crime according to a fixed and uniform scheme is a fact more clearly attested than any other in the moral history of man. We have here parallel chains of evidence formed with extreme care, under the most different circumstances, and all pointing in the same direction, all of them forcing us to the conclusion that the offenses of men are the result not so much of the vices of the individual offender as of that state of society into which that individual is thrown. This is an inference resting on broad and tangible proofs accessible to all the world, and as such cannot be overturned or even impeached by any of those hypotheses with which metaphysicians and theologians have hitherto perplexed the study of past events. Those readers who are acquainted with the matter in which, in the physical world, the operations of the laws of nature are constantly disturbed, will expect to find in the moral world disturbances equally active. I'll let it go to sleep again, sorry. Okay. Those readers who are acquainted with the manner in which all in which, in the physical world, the operations of the laws of nature are constantly disturbed, will expect to find in the moral world disturbances equally active. Such aberrations proceed, in both instances, from minor laws, which, at particular points, meet the larger laws, and thus alter their normal action. Of this, the science of mechanics affords a good example in the instance of the beautiful theory called the parallelogram of forces, according to which the forces are to each other in the same proportion as is the diagonal of their respective parallelograms. This is a law pregnant with great results. It is connected with those important mechanical resources, the composition and resolution of forces, and no one acquainted with the evidence on which it stands ever thought of questioning its truth. But the moment we avail ourselves of it for practical purposes, we find that in its action it is warped by other laws, such as those concerning the friction of air and the different density of the bodies on which we operate, arising from their chemical composition, or, as some suppose, from their atomic arrangement. Perturbations being thus let in, the pure and simple action of the mechanical law disappears. Still, and although the results of the law are incessantly disturbed, the law itself remains intact. Just in the same way, the great social law that the moral actions of men are the product not of their volition, but of their antecedents, is itself liable to disturbances which trouble its operation without affecting its truth. And this is quite sufficient to explain those slight variations which we find from year to year in the total amount of crime produced by the same country. Indeed, looking at the fact that the moral world is far more abundant in materials than the physical world, the only ground for astonishment is that these variations should not be greater. And from the circumstance that the discrepancies are so trifling, we may form some idea of the prodigious energy of those vast social laws which, though constantly interrupted, seem to triumph over every obstacle, and which, when examined by the aid of large numbers, scarcely undergo any sensible perturbation. nor is it merely the crimes of men which are marked by this uniformity of sequence. Even the number of marriages annually contracted is determined not by the temper and wishes of individuals, but by large general facts over which individuals can exercise no authority. It is now known that marriages bear a fixed and definite relation to the price of corn. And in England, the experience of a century has proved that, instead of having any connection with personal feelings, they are simply regulated by the average earnings of the great mass of people. So that this immense social and religious institution is not only swayed, but is completely controlled by the price of food and the rate of wages. In other cases, uniformity has been detected. Thus, the causes of the uniformity are still unknown. Thus, to give a curious instance, we are now able to prove that even the aberrations of memory are marked by this general character of necessity and invariable order. The post offices of London and Paris have lately published returns in the number of letters which the writers, through forgetfulness, omitted to direct. And making allowance for the difference of circumstances, the returns are year after year copies of each other. Year after year, the same proportion, it should be proportion, I think, but it says proportion, of letter writers forget this simple act, so that for each successive period, we can actually foretell the number of persons whose memory will fail them in regard to this trifling and, as it might appear, accidental occurrence. To those who have a steady conception of the regularity of events and have firmly seized the great truth that the actions of men, being guided by their antecedents, are in reality never inconsistent, but, however capricious they may appear, only form part of one vast scheme of universal order, of which we, in the present state of knowledge, can barely see the outline, to those who understand this, which is at once the key and the basis of history, the facts just deduced are so far from being strange, will be precisely what would have been expected, and ought long since to have been known. Indeed, the progress of inquiry is becoming so rapid and so earnest that I entertain little doubt that before another century has elapsed, the chain of evidence will be complete, and it will be as rare to find an historian who denies the undeviating regularity of the moral world as it now is to find a philosopher who denies the regularity of the material world. I'm wondering about doing some commentary on these readings instead of just doing the readings. Let's just keep it consistent. We'll end it here. Okay, so that's what we're going to be discussing on Friday.